You know, it's about just allowing the Bible to flow over us. So it's about reading it or listening to it. I know some people, you know, reading is not something which they do very much, but the whole of the Bible is available on tape, on CD. So if reading is an issue for you, you can listen to it. It's becoming acquainted with it. It's allowing it to flow over us. The second thing is about, verse 15, it talks about having learnt something. The way you know if you've learnt something is if you can teach it to somebody else.
This is GBC Web TV, on the internet at gbcweb.tv. Welcome to Greenford Baptist Church in West London. Here you can watch inspired biblical teaching and find out how to apply God's Word to your everyday lives. On the website you can also listen to audio versions of these programs or download them as podcasts.
If I went round this morning and I went round one at a time and I said, Richard, do you think the Bible is important? Richard would say,
yeah.
And if I went round every one of you, Ismat, do you think the Bible is important?
Very important.
And I went round and I asked everyone that question, I think I'd get the answer, yes, or very important, or amen, pastor, or something like that from all of you. Yeah? Is that? Nod if you're with me. Okay. But if I went round and asked you with some different questions, like, how often do you read the Bible? Or how easy do you find it to understand? Or have you ever read the Bible all the way through from cover to cover? I think the answers would be a lot more mixed. It's a survey done recently of regular churchgoers in the UK about their reading of the Bible. And here is a staggering fact. 2/3 of regular churchgoers, that's people who go to church almost every week, do not read the Bible at all between the times they're in church from Sunday to Sunday. 2/3 in the UK of people who go to church almost every week do not read the Bible at all from Sunday to Sunday. Now, I believe that if Jesus is the Lord of our lives, which he ought to be, then that ought to affect every single area and aspect of our lives. Whether it's from how we do the shopping to how we do the washing up, whether it's from our attitudes to our neighbours or our attitudes to recycling our rubbish, whether it's from buying a car or mowing the lawn, whatever it is that we're doing, every aspect and part of our lives should be affected by the fact that Jesus is our Lord. Amen? Amen. Abraham Kuyper was at one time Prime Minister of the Netherlands. He also was a theologian and a pastor. And I love this quote. He wrote this. There is no square inch, obviously before metrication, there was no square inch of creation over which Jesus Christ does not shout, "This is mine!" Amen? Amen. Now, if that's going to be a reality in our lives, I am convinced that we need to be reading and understanding God's Word, God's living Word, the Bible. God has given us this book so that we can become more and more the people He has created us to be, that we can reach our potential in Him, that we know what to do in life. This should affect the way that you handle your rubbish, you wash your car, you mow your lawn, you do your shopping. Amen? But if it remains a closed book on the shelf, how much impact will it have on you? Absolutely none. So one of our objectives as a church is to get everybody who's a part of the church here taking the Bible into their lives, reading the Bible, ideally daily, or listening to it daily. Not just that, talking to other people about the Bible as well. We want to do that in our meeting together groups. That's why we encourage people to be in those, or in a house group, or whatever other group it is that we're in. We don't just want to get people reading it, we want to get people studying it. Some parts of the Bible are easy to understand. Some parts of the Bible are difficult to understand. Now you reflect, all of you have been to school. Different levels of education. You reflect back on your schooling. Was it the stuff that was really easy that most enriched you? Was it the stuff that was really easy that actually helped your understanding most? It was the stuff that was a bit harder, wasn't it? Yeah? And if we just read the easy bits, we miss all the bits that actually can help us most in life. So what I want to do this morning, we're going to look at a passage in 2 Timothy. It's the passage you saw on the screen at the beginning, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 10 to 17. We're going to remind ourselves from that why the Bible is so important. And then we're going to look, we're going to share together, and we're going to look, and we're going to watch a short promotional video as well. Look at some of the resources, some of the ways, some of the practical things that we can get more of the Bible into us and consequently our lives more in line with God's word, more in line with his will and purpose for us. So my aim is not to make you feel guilty about the fact you don't read the Bible enough. I want you to read the Bible more, but I want you to go away from this morning inspired, encouraged, and with some new resources to help you get more into the Bible and more of the Bible into you. So that's where we're going. Amen? Didn't sound too convinced about that. Okay, turn with me to, if you've not found it yet, 2 Timothy chapter 3. Now, if you've got one of our church Bibles, we're beginning at the page of 1,000, bottom of page 1,196. Now, 2 Timothy was written towards the end of Paul's life. And it's written to, you've guessed it, Timothy. And Timothy was a young man, new in God, probably converted through Paul's ministry. And so Paul is writing to Timothy to encourage him. And it really gives a powerful insight into what it is to live as a Christian. So we're going to pick it up in verse 10 and we're going to run down to just verse 17 this morning. So beginning at verse 10. You, however, Timothy, you know all about my teaching, my way of life, my purpose, faith, patience, love, endurance, persecutions, sufferings. What kinds of things happened to me in Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra? The persecutions I endured, yet the Lord rescued me from all of them. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. While evil men and impostors go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived. We know that Timothy had accompanied Paul on some of his missions. He'd seen Paul's life close up, how he lived, what he did. He hadn't just been along to the talks and the public presentations. He lived with Paul. He'd seen what his life was really like. He'd seen the suffering. He'd seen the difficulties, the events being referred to here. Let's turn back. Let's go back to Acts chapter 13. There's an account of some of the things that Paul is talking about here. Back in Acts chapter 13. Page 1,109, if you're still looking for it in one of our church Bibles. Acts chapter 13, and we're going to pick it up from verse 49. This is what Paul is writing to Timothy about. These are the events. The word of the Lord spread through the whole region, but the Jews incited the God-fearing women of high standing and the leading men of the city. They stirred up persecution against Paul and Barnabas, expelled them from their region. So they shook the dust from their feet in protest against them and went to Iconium. And the disciples were filled with joy and with the Holy Spirit. At Iconium, Paul and Barnabas went as usual into the Jewish synagogue. There they spoke so effectively that a great number of Jews and Gentiles believed. But the Jews who refused to believe stirred up the Gentiles and poisoned their minds against the brothers. So Paul and Barnabas spent considerable time there, speaking boldly for the Lord, who confirmed the message of his grace by enabling them to do miraculous signs and wonders. The people of the city were divided. Some sided with the Jews, others with the apostles. Then there was a plot afoot among the Jews and Gentiles, together with their leaders, to ill-treat them and stone them. But they found out about it and fled to the Lycaonian cities of Lystra and Derbe and of the surrounding country. Let's drop down to verse 19. Some of the Jews came from Antioch and Iconium, and they won the crowd over. They stoned Paul and dragged him outside the city, thinking he was dead. But after the disciples had gathered around him, he got up and went back to the city. The next day, he and Barnabas left for Derbe. In fact, says Paul, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. I don't know, some of you who've been around church for a long time will remember years ago it was quite fashionable to have little promise boxes. You used to be able to buy them in Christian bookshops, and there'd be a little card inside with a promise from God's word, promise for the day, and you'd look at one each day. Anybody remember those? Yeah, okay. Now here's a promise from God that I bet wasn't in any of those promise boxes. But it's a promise from God. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. I know some people are really into claiming promises from God. You don't need to claim this one. In your workplace, in your family, in your street, with your friends. If you live a godly life, it's going to provoke a response from people around you. And it's not just that promise there in 2 Timothy. Jesus said something very similar. Let me read to you. Mark 8, verse 34. It says this. If anyone would come after me, says Jesus, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Taking up his cross is speaking about suffering and difficulty. Elsewhere also, 1 Peter chapter 2. Let me again just read couple of verses to you, 1 Peter chapter 2 and verse 20. How is it to your credit if you receive a beating for doing wrong and endure it? But if you suffer for doing good and you endure it, this is commendable before God. Listen, to this you were called, because Christ Jesus suffered for you, leaving you an example that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin. No deceit was found in his mouth. When they hurled their insults at him, he did not retaliate. When he suffered, he made no threats. Instead, he entrusted himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, so that we might die to sin and live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. Philip Towner says this: genuine godliness evokes a combative response in unbelievers. Genuine godliness evokes a combative response in unbelievers. Let's just pause for a moment. And we didn't have a testimony time this morning. That's not a complaint. But here's an opportunity. I want you to think back over your lives recently. Slightly more wider than the recently of just the testimony time this last week. And just maybe think of some times when, because you have been serving God, because you have been doing the right thing, because you have been faithful, difficulty has come your way. And I'd like to invite a few of you, just, we're not after your life story, but some just short examples of how that's been for you.
Recently at work, last academic year, one of the managers in my work said, "Boss, why are you such a fool? Is it because of your religion? When people are just doing all this to you and you're not complaining, you're always smiling." And to me, in itself, that showed me that, okay, I'm not letting my Jesus down.
Thank you. Who else? I can see a hand. I don't know whose hand it is. I can just see this. Ah, Josephine.
God has been wonderful. The couple of months ago, I had difficult times with Junior, and because of the prayers of the church, and on occasion I thought I was going to take him back home, but I thought, where is my God, and where is my Bible, and where is my faith? And I put faith in God, and I said that I have to address my problems myself. And I prayed and read the Bible, and each time in the morning and on very strange occasion, I will go to Junior and I will pray. And the Spirit of God is good, and he will live to give testimonies. And Junior is a changed person. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Situations where, because we've been following God, sometimes difficult things come our way. Joan?
Not to be specific, but I find, as I think other people do, that within family, you are a bit of an outsider if you are a Christian and trying to live a godly life. The rest of the family don't really like it.
Sometimes you find when families are all believers and lots of trouble starts coming from Satan hitting. And this year has been in our family, it's just hitting from one side to another. And we know it's Satan. And sometimes the face of God, you just bless God and just with strong feeling of faith of God, just stand there and discount Satan, because he wants to just grab your mind and mix you up with different things of worries and everything. But every time you have to be very strong to get Satan out of the way and just with faith stand by Jesus and just pray.
Thank you. Thank you. So as difficulties come our way, you've heard it in various testimonies, it is going back to God's word. This is a part of God's provision for us. You know, in Paul's day, he wrote to Timothy, "Evil men and imposters go from bad to worse, deceiving and being deceived." That could be a description of life today, as we live for God in our context today. We don't experience the intense opposition and persecution in this country that people do in other countries around the world. We featured some of those countries last week. But here, in our context, in our families, in our work, in our society, as we seek to live with God, that does generate opposition. And this is what Paul says. This is the context you're in. But as for you, verse 14, continue in what you have learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learnt it, and how from infancy you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, people a little bit cleverer than me have gone through these two verses. Let's see how we get on. We try and do this together. Gone through these two verses here and drawn out four different disciplines, four different ways that people can take in what the Bible teaches. So let's read those two verses again. As for you, continue in what you've learned and have become convinced of, because you know those from whom you learned it, and how from infancy you've known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So what are the things, do you think? Look at those two verses, verses 14 and 15. What are those disciplines? What are the ways that we can take in, these two verses speak about, the ways that we can take in what the Bible teaches? What can you see there?
Just remembering things, scripture verses that you've learned as a child, and committing them to memory.
Committing to memory and remembering, according back to memory. Rachel.
Yes, I was going to mention on the infancy, learning things from infancy, and the fact that actually gives us as parents a responsibility.
Yeah, very good.
Very good.
Excuse me, Andy.
I was going to say as well, teach children from an early age about the Bible stories and what's in there.
Okay, thank you.
It mentions being convinced of, so I think it's about reading the word of God, but becoming convinced that it is for you, and to walk in the light of that conviction in your life, in what you say, in what you think. So.
Yes, it's moving from it just being information, actually being something that becomes a conviction for us. Now, when we're reading something, we can read a novel, we can read all sorts of things. Great big difference in reading that and actually being convinced that this is true for me. This is true in my life. Yeah.
It says to continue, so I was thinking, don't be changed by what you already know is right.
Yeah, continuing it on and on. Yeah, very good. Denise, did I see your hand up earlier on?
To do with convincing, believing in what you're reading and believing in what you've read. In other words, we should have faith for what you can't see it. You can't see what you're actually being asked to believe in, but still you need to have that faith to actually believe that word that you're reading about and that you've been actually been taught.
Very good. Thank you.
Not only reading, believing, but also practicing what it tells us to do. Practicing.
Yeah.
And often that is very hard.
Yeah, very good. Thank you. Carol?
It says you have known the Holy Scriptures. But also I was just thinking from last week, from Joshua, it said, meditate on God's word night and day. Don't let it depart from you. Be careful to obey everything that's in it. So, you should really got to apply it. Otherwise, it's not going to do anything.
Yeah, very good. Very good. Thank you. So the four that the clever people pulled out, which I think we've covered just about all of, but I'll just run through the list here. The first is becoming acquainted with it in verse 15. So, it's about just allowing the Bible to flow over us. So it's about reading it or listening to it. I know some people, reading is not something which they do very much, but the whole of the Bible is available on tape, on CD. So if reading is an issue for you, you can listen to it. But it's becoming acquainted with it. It's allowing it to flow over us. The second thing is about, verse 15, talks about having learnt something. The way you know if you've learnt something is if you can teach it to somebody else. The way you know if you understand something is that you can explain it to somebody else. If you can't tell somebody else or explain it to somebody else, you've not learnt it. So that's the second thing, becoming acquainted with it, having learnt it, being convinced of its truth. That's one of the things that came up. It's not just that this is an interesting document, this is a fascinating perspective, but actually this is true. Not just true in a big general sense, but this is true for me as well. This is true for my life. Being convinced of that. And the other thing in verse 14 is always continue in learning. Now, I've been a Christian this year. In fact, it's this week, I would have been a Christian for exactly 40 years, in the middle of this week. And for 40 years, I've been reading the Bible. When I first became a Christian, the guy that led me to help me become a Christian, one of the very first things he did when I told him I'd become a Christian was he gave me a pack of Bible reading notes from Scripture Union, incidentally. And I have used those for years. I've used sorts of other things. So most days of my life in the last 40 years, I've read the Bible. I've read the Bible from cover to cover quite a number of times. There was a 4 or 5 year period. I did it year after year. I read the Bible all the way through in a year, cover to cover. I did an A-level. I have a degree in the Bible. I have a master's in biblical interpretation. But I am still learning. I'm still reading Scripture every day. I'm still seeing new things in Scripture. God is still speaking to me out of His living Word. Whatever point, whatever stage we're at, we've never finished learning. So we continue in learning. And we become, it says here, wise for salvation, which is in contrast to being deceived. So let's read this verse 16, then we're going to talk about this for a while. 16 and 17. All Scripture, how much?
All
Scripture is God-breathed. It's useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. I love that phrase, God breathed. God breathed. This is why the Bible is so important to us. This is why the Bible is different from every other book in the world. Our world is full of books. There are lots of books about the Bible. But the Bible is different from every other written document in our world because it is the only book that is God-breathed, meaning that it is inspired by God. It's given life by the living God. This is not a dead historic document. This is a living word. It has God's life breathed into it. Which is why when we read it, we find God speaking to us through it. Because it's alive, it's relevant, it's for now, it's for today. This is a living book. Now in our world today, we have all sorts of voices advising us to do all sorts of things, all sorts of values that are around. And everything that you watch, whether it's at the cinema, on television, everything you listen to, whether it's on the radio, whether even it's music or speaking, everything that you read, whether it's a novel, whether it's a daily newspaper, whether it's an internet site, all of these things are guided by values of one sort or another. You know, we think that, let's just take an example, our daily newspapers give us a factual account of what takes place in our world. When there's a big event, you go and buy four different ones and read them. No matter which four you pick, try and pick four that look different on the front page, you know, different sizes. And you'll find that the descriptions are completely different. Gordon, we'll just pick something random, you know. Gordon Brown, historic step forward. Gordon Brown, total failure. Gordon Brown misses the point. Could be three headlines on the same day, the same event, the same speech. Or you look at the account of a conflict. Or even the account of a football match. I'm just looking at a sports writer, journalist in our congregation. You know, you read two different accounts of the same football match and you get a feel about sometimes what that journalist's viewpoint are. You know, they're not just factual accounts. It'd be deadly boring if they were, frankly. But when we read those things, there are all sorts of values that are there and they just seep into our lives. Which is why it's so important that we allow the Bible to guide us. Why it's so important we spend time reading or listening to the Bible. Here are five things. Five different things that it seems to me that it's essential that we allow, why we allow the Bible to guide us. The Bible puts us right about what God is like. Now, some of these we're going to have some conversation about. Let's talk about this one. The Bible puts us right about what God is like. What are some of the views about God that are just around, that colour the things that we see and hear and read, that are wrong, that the Bible puts us right about? Let's just generate a list. Come on, it's not difficult.
Good works.
If you do good things, then God will love you. Then
you can be good enough for God. Yeah. Yeah? Okay. It's wrong. The Bible tells us that's wrong. What else? Come on, should be loads. Denisa.
That God puts us through difficulties so in order to teach us a lesson.
Okay. God somehow sends us hard stuff just to teach us things.
God is dead.
Yeah, God's dead. God's not there. God's irrelevant. Not true.
He's distant and doesn't care about us.
Yeah, distant, doesn't care about us. It's not true.
God is a figment of our imagination.
Yeah. God can be dealt with in psychotherapy. He's just a figment of our imagination.
He's got no power. Just look at what's going on in the world.
Got no power. Not true.
An old man with a long beard sitting up on a cloud.
Not true. What else? Any others?
That he takes the blame for everything that goes wrong.
That he's a great big judge.
That he only cares about you if you're already a Christian.
Yeah, I was going to say he favours oneself people over another.
Other forms of God. Not the real God. Mm-hmm. The living God.
Mm-hmm. Loads and loads and loads of things. So we could continue this conversation for a long time, pulling up all sorts of different things. And the Bible sets us right about that. If you want to know what God is like, this is the source. In addition to our relationship with him, this tells us what he's like. EastEnders won't tell you what God is like. neither will the daily whatever. This is where it puts us right about what God is like. There are so many wrong ideas about God around. The Bible puts us right about those. Secondly, connected with that, the Bible leads us to the real Jesus. Not the Jesus of fantasy, the Jesus of fiction. I've got a book I was given some years ago. I forget the title of it now. It's a portrayal of the truth about Jesus. And the truth is that actually he was one of the first people to use psychedelic mushrooms for hallucinogenic experiences. I've got a whole book that argues this. Whole book, it's 200 pages, that puts forward this thesis. I think I'd rather the version in the Bible. I mean, there are so many. I just use that as a silly example. But there are so many things. But it is from the Bible that we find out what Jesus, the real Jesus, is like. The Bible puts us right on the facts of our faith. The Bible helps us to sort out right from wrong. You know, there are so many values. I mean, again, I could go round and ask, but you know, you look at the things in our media that are taken. That is how it is. It's just assumed in the way that, you know, gravity is assumed. That actually getting money is one of the most important things in life. Accumulating possessions. You know, if you've got a lot of the stuff, that means you are a more significant person. All of that sort of materialism and all of that that's around. Sexuality. Sex isn't just for marriage, sex is for anywhere and with whoever and all of that sort of stuff. It's just taken as, you know, you're watching a drama or a soap or on TV or you're whatever, and it, you know, it's just assumed that, you know, the first thing that you do when you meet somebody is you get a bed with them. And you see all of that stuff all the time. Where do you think a lot of people take out their values from? They watch that, they assume that's how it is, in the same way that if you drop something, it hits the ground, it's gravity. If that's all you feed yourself on, that's what you think life is like. The Bible puts us right on those things. On things that are right, things that are wrong, things that are good for us, things that are harmful. And the Bible equips us for action. God's people are to be people who are active, who are changing things, who are making a difference in our world. God's word equips God's people to do God's work. I say that again. God's word equips God's people to do God's work. And if you haven't got the word, you're not equipped to do the work. No excuses, no, you know, it's part of what God provides you with. To live in our world, to serve him in our world. And if this is not inside you, you are not properly equipped to do the things that God calls you to do. Part of God's provision for us. You know, and it's all scripture. I made us say that together earlier on. It is all scripture. All scripture. You know, we need to feed on the whole of the Bible or our diet is poor. If you just ate your favourite food, would you be healthy? I'm not saying you shouldn't eat your favourite food, but if you just ate your favourite food, would you be healthy? I'm not going to go around and ask what your favourite foods are. You need in your diet a variety of food. Same with the Bible. Here's a poem. I like this. This poem is written by Amos Wells. Enjoy this. I supposed I knew my Bible, reading piecemeal, hit or miss. Now a bit of John or Matthew, now a snatch of Genesis. Certain chapters of Isaiah, certain Psalms, the 23rd, 12th of Romans, 5th of Proverbs. Yes, I thought I knew the word. But I found that thorough reading was a different thing to do. And the way was unfamiliar when I read the Bible through. You who like to play at Bible, dip and dabble here and there, just before you kneel aweary and yawn through a hurried prayer. You who treat the crown of writings as you treat no other book, just a paragraph disjointed, just a crude, impatient look. Try a worthier procedure. Try a broad and steady view. And you will kneel in very rapture when you read the Bible through. I like that. We need to be doing that. We need to feed on all the Bible, or our diet is poor. So, let me go round. I wonder if some of you might want to share very briefly some of the ways that you have found that currently work for you in getting the Bible inside you. And I'm going to talk about one or two then, and we're going to watch a short video, which is a brilliant resource on the internet. It's free. We're going to watch the promotional video for that in a few moments' time. But let's go round and let's just see some of the different ways. Just think about what you find most helpful, what you found helpful recently, and just share that. If you could get the video set up for me to watch, whoever's doing that for me, that would be really helpful. So it's ready to go in a few seconds. Okay, what's helpful for you, Steve?
Listen to it in the car on a CD.
Listen to it in the car on a CD. I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll turn that on, set again.
Listening to it in a car on a CD.
Fantastic. What else? Ismet, for you.
Someone says, pray while you read the Bible and read while you pray.
Okay, so you're reading it while you're praying. And as you're talking to God, God talks to you. Very good. Joan, I'm going to pick on a few people as well. So, Joan.
Starting the day with it, but for me it's lovely because I don't have to get up early nowadays.
So what do you do each day, typically?
Typically each day I make a mug of tea.
Yeah.
Then go back, and I'm using the for me at the moment I'm working through the Northumbria community's Celtic prayer, which has different readings each day, and it's a mixture of readings. It's not and it goes through various topics. And at present, I'm finding that's good for me.
Excellent, very good. Okay, let's a few others. Adam.
I'm listening to it on the internet. Well, not actually on the internet. It's on a podcast that you can download and put onto your iPlayer or something. And it's somebody who's reading through the Bible but also commentating on it at the same time. So he comments on the verse and then reads it and so on.
Okay, we're going to look at a verse. Maybe the one you use. We're going to watch a promo for that, something like that in a moment, so which is available on your mobile phone, on your podcast, on the internet and all the rest of it. So.
I listen to it on Premier Radio and also watch the God channels, some of the good God channels.
Okay, yeah.
For me, I listen to it on Primary Radio, and I read my Bible morning and night. And I've been going through 2.5 years of trial and tribulation, but God has helped me to fight the good fight of faith and lay everything aside and hold on to eternal life now. Amen. So I'm stronger now.
Excellent.
Thank God.
Very good. Any others? Yeah, Josephine.
When I read the Bible, as I always do, all our experiences of all the good things, we should share it with our neighbors, our friends at work and everywhere.
Right. Thank you. Lots of different ways. I would I'll just stop with Denzel in passing. You had your hand up.
Yeah. I read it a bit like a mystery tour sometimes. I read a passage, and often there's a reference in it in the column to another passage. So I go and read that, and often that has a reference to another passage. And you start with a thought, and somehow it just goes off, and you just learn so much. Sometimes I concentrate on one passage, but then there's the kind of mystery tour aspect, which I learn from.
Okay, excellent, excellent. We're going to watch this in just a moment, but before we do that, there are Bible reading notes, and we've pushed some of those this morning. But the beauty of the Scripture Union package is why I push Scripture Union. So if you use Scripture Union for a number of years, you will go through the whole of the Bible. It will systematically, over a number of years, take you through, and you've got a comment each day that actually helps you apply that. And there's a whole variety of ways that that is that is served, including the one we're going to see on the screen in a few moments. Reading the Bible through in a year, do you know, you can, if you're just taking just under 15 minutes a day, you can read the Bible from cover to cover in a year. Don't start at Genesis and read for 15 minutes and work through to Revelation. That, I mean, you can do that, but it's a really hard... I mean, Genesis, Exodus is all right, but when you get into Numbers and Chronicles, if you get that far, it's a bit difficult. But you can either buy, it's on the stall here, you can buy a book that actually gives you a reading each day that will take you through the Bible in a year. You can download a Bible reading plan from the internet. The one that I used, we gave a couple of chapters from the Old Testament, a passage from the Psalms, a chapter from the New Testament. I did that repeatedly, I forget, four or five times, using a different Bible version to the one that I was familiar with. And I found that really helpful. And took me through the whole. I'd encourage that. Meeting together groups, reading the Bible together in the meeting together groups. As you meet, most of us in the church here are in a meeting together group. If you're not, you want to find out more, Andy Robertson, stand up. This is the man who will help you find other people to meet together in a meeting together group. We had 15 people recently ask him to be joining it, meeting together groups. We're wanting to get people doing that, a reading together. You can also use commentaries. Home groups, listening to the Sunday teaching, all these different ways that are there. But this is another way as well. Andy, show us the video.
So what is WordLive all about? Join Kate and Jim for the next 3 minutes and find out. So, what are you doing? Life is busy with stuff, but there are times when we ask big questions. Like, why am I here? Who is God? What is the Bible all about anyway? Some of us want to get into the Bible more, but there never seems to be the time. Stop! Scripture Union has the answer. WordLive is a free multimedia Bible experience. It's updated every day and written by loads of different people. You can get WordLive by email, online, RSS, podcast, or even on your mobile. Experience visual meditations, video, songs, deeper study, and lots of creative stuff. A great place to think about your questions, go deeper into the Bible, and connect with God. Try it now. Visit wordlive.org.
Meet Kate. Kate likes running, aerobics, ice cream, Facebook, and God. Kate wants to connect with God more and get into the Bible. Kate's friend Emma, from aerobics class, told her about WordLive. WordLive is a free, online Bible experience, updated every day and available online, by email, RSS and mobile. Kate loves WordLive and downloads the podcast to listen to as she runs before work. Kate has been inspired by the visual meditations on WordLive and has started praying again. Kate feels excited about the Bible again and told her friends about it on Facebook. You can get excited about the Bible too and connect with God. Get started today. Visit wordlive.org.
Meet Jim. Jim likes football, playing the drums, pizza, and God. Jim wants to connect with God more and get into the Bible, but it's not easy to fit it into his hectic life. Jim's mate Fred, the singer in the band, told him about WordLive. WordLive is a free online Bible experience, updated every day and available online, by email, RSS and mobile. Jim gets the WordLive email and sometimes visits the WordLive website during his lunch hour at work. Jim enjoys the visual meditations and worship songs and often chats to Fred about it at band practice. Jim feels his relationship with God is moving forward because he's getting into the Bible. Jim thinks WordLive has helped him get excited about the Bible again. You can get excited about the Bible too and connect with God. Try it today. Visit wordlive.org.
Warren uses WordLive. How's it work for you?
Really simple. A, it's a good reminder because it comes via email to my computer. So it's in one of my emails. And you think, oh, must do that. And so you click it open. You can just read the Bible passage they've given you with the short prayer beforehand. Or one of the ways I like to do is to lean back and allow somebody to be reading it to you over the speaker of your computer. That's very helpful. And there's also worship song you can click to, and it's all there. You just, the icons are there, and you just click to whatever you feel like for the day. It's brilliant.
And if you are a Facebook user, WordLife has got its own page on Facebook. You can actually access WordLife through Facebook, and you can access the other currently 1,089 Facebook users who are registered with WordLife. And you can actually contact them and all of that sort of stuff as well if you want to do that. So here's another way, and it's free. Another resource that is there. What I'd like you to do now, I'm going to pray for you in just a moment. We've almost finished. I'd like you to think before God for a moment about what you're going to do differently as a result of this morning. What is it coming out of this morning that you are now going to do differently to get more of God's word into you? Just pause for a moment, think about that. You might want to write something down. You might just simply want to think. You certainly will want to say something to God. I'll pray for you in a moment.
Father God, I thank you for your living word, the Bible. I thank you that it is a living word. Even though it's thousands of years old, it is alive today, bringing change and transformation today. Father, I ask that you will help us as your people, as individuals and as a church community, to engage more and more with your word, to allow your living word to fill and transform our lives, that we can be equipped to do your work in the places that you have called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
We do hope you've enjoyed and benefited from this presentation. To learn more about what the Bible teaches us and how to apply this to our everyday lives, check out our biblical teaching and other videos at gbcweb.tv.